Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 13, and there are 8 questions. But first, a normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. The first question is a commentary expression, Hadayavattu. One asks, what does it mean when we say that the mind is in the heart? The Buddha never said that. That's important to notice. He never said where the mind resides, and that is actually very wise. And neither do the Abhidhamma say where the mind resides. So this is what we call the mind-body problem, or philosophy of mind. In modern philosophy, is what is mind? How is it connected to the body? And this is not evident. Most people think it's the brain, and there are also something that the brain is involved. But the brain probably doesn't make consciousness de novo. It's more like a radio doesn't make the music coming out of the radio. It processes the information and displays it and puts it out the loudspeaker, but it doesn't make it. And so also your computer doesn't make the information that is coming out on your computer screen now. It's come from somewhere else. Similarly with the mind. So if we should just see from a neurological problem, when you prick your finger with a needle and you feel pain, where does the consciousness actually start? The Buddha says it starts with the contact. The contact is the sense organ meeting the object. Right there, the sense consciousness arises. This means that the sense consciousness from pricking the needle, in this case is tactile consciousness, is arising out in the first neuron. The first neuron is the first nerve cell is located in the skin. This nerve cell then has is touched by a dendrite and have an axon that goes all the way up in the arm and into the back, into the spinal cord. That's the second neuron. The second neuron fires then up through the spinal cord up to the brain and hits the third neuron. So you can say that all the neurons in the body are actually extensions of the brain. So we call it the peripheral nerve system. So there's a central nerve system, which is the brain and the spinal cord, and the peripheral nerve system. Then there's an additional nerve system also called the autonomic nerve system, which is down here in the body and in the heart, corresponds to the brain nerve, of which there is 10. The number of neurons outside the brain, interestingly, is at the same order as inside the brain. Here in the plumbing and in the around the heart and in all the autonomous plexi, which is small collections, small brains, you can say, of nerve cells, there are the same number of neurons, approximately 100 billion neurons, as in the brain. What all these neurons are doing down here in the plumbing, nobody knows really. It has been assumed that they are taking place for regulation of the intestines and how they contract and so on, and also the heart. And there's some truth in that, of course, but it's their additional functions. And basically, neurology doesn't know at this point of view. Much of it is sensory and motoric. So sending 8 signals, what's happening, is the intestine dilated or not, is the arm here or there. This the brain has to know to coordinate movement and to if you get pricked by a needle, to move the hand and so on. But from a Buddhist point of view, the sense consciousness arises where the contact actually arises. Where the context takes place. This also means that in the eye, when you see something, the first neuron will be the cones that are lying inside the retina. So this is outside the brain. Huh? Then it goes through nervous opticals and inside the brain. But the eye is a sensory organ that is outside the brain, and it's an extension of the brain. And similarly are all other neurons in the body. So already here you see that the modern idea that the consciousness is only located in the brain has to be edited or reformulated, because the sense organs of course takes part in the arising of this sense consciousness. But just to make a final note, Hadayavattu is a commentarial expression. It means the heart base, and this was thought to be in old time also outside of Buddhism, in for example in the chakras within in Hinduism, there it was thought that consciousness resided in the heart. But you can say that consciousness actually resides not only in all the neurons part of the body, but it's reside outside the body also. It's non-local, has a non-local aspect. So it arise in connection with the body, but it can be, if you take a mental object or take any other object that is inside the body, then there will be consciousness outside the body also. It's a form of radiation. Not electromagnetic radiation, but another form of radiation. Not yet really described or discovered, but probably experimentally verifiable in our time. It is my hope, at least. So Hadayavattu is an expression that we say, this is something from the commentaries. It's not something Buddha have said. It's not something that is in the Tipitaka text. And we have to kind of like say, the consciousness does not only reside in the heart. And it probably resides more in the brain than in the heart. But also in the heart, there's a lot of neurons. They have to take care of the electrical circuitry that makes the heart pump and make the heart pulse. But that these electrical signals is what you can see in an EKG, an electrocardiogram. This is the electrical signals in the heart, that all the cells have electrical properties, so that they can send signals. They have pacemaker function. So you can say in this regard also, all other cells has an electrical membrane potential approximately minus 100 to minus 30 millivolt, that is electrical potential over the cellular membrane. So in this sense, they could take part in conscious and in nerve signaling also. So nerve cells, that's a specialization of cells that are particularly good at sending electrical signals to each other. But other cells are also participating with so-called gap junctions. There are two cells lying close together, there's a small channel that it can sense ions and thereby electrical signals from one cell to the next cell. So they are communicating through these gap junctions. And also, this also goes with electrical signals. This, we do not normally count that as nerve signaling, but it's a kind of communication from cell to cell, suffice to say. So there are also the consciousness, where does consciousness reside, is not an easy thing to actually point out. And that's why it's good that Buddha didn't say anything about it, because it's distributed. It's a distributed thing. It's a non-local thing. And has nothing specifically to do with electrical signals. This is in nerve cells, in axons. It is something more fundamental than that. And it does not depend on that. There are beings that are conscious without a brain. There are beings that are conscious without a body. There are beings that are conscious with a body made of light. They have no brain. They have no electrical signal. Still, they have consciousness. So this entails that, of course, consciousness is something else. It can be connected with it. Like information can be connected with your computer and your radio and and even your fridge. If your fridge has some small regulator inside, there's some information connected with it and passing through the different parts of the fridge and different parts of the computer. But this doesn't make them conscious, but they process information. Question two is about, it's mentioned in the text that you cannot feel the water element. There's four Mahabhutas element in the physical part of Buddhism. They are what? They are the earth element, which we should today consider as solidity. Which, if you go down on the, this is solidity, this is what we feel macroscopically is solidity. What is on the microscopic scale? It's extension, something that push apart. From a molecular point of view, I think it looks mostly like the covalent bond. The covalent bond is something that has a specific distance that keeps two atoms apart. And it's usually because there's a shared electron that keeps this distance 1.8 angstrom all the time. So this is a microscopic basis of, but it could be even more fundamental further down than that. Then there's a water element is something that is cohesive, is pulling together something. So for example, in water molecules, in fluid water, you have this, water is kind of like a V-shaped molecule with an oxygen and two hydrogens. And because the electrons is a little more about in the hydrogen end than in the oxygen end, because there's two ends here, then it's become negatively charged. This means there's a dipole. This means there's a small magnetic force, an electrostatic force between the individual water molecules that keeps them together. Slightly, not very much. It's not like a covalent bond that is rigid. It's more like a soft bond that can kind of like just pulling a little bit. And therefore, when you pour out water, it doesn't evaporate into gas. It keeps together. So this cohesive, something that pulls together instead of extension, pushing away, this is the water element. The third element is heat. And the fourth element is motion. Heat in modern language will be corresponds to vibration. Because you see the atoms vibrate more, and you can see it in a microscope. There's brown movements. Was the subject of one of the five papers Albert Einstein published in 1905, Brownian motion. Brownian motion is if you see a bacteria, for example, or a small cold particle, anything that is microscopic, and then you look at it in a fluid in a microscope, it's lying down vibrating. It's not still. Why not? Because it's bombarded by billions of water atoms, and they are not bombarding it at all the same side. So it's kind of like moving a little around because of this thermic bombardment by water atoms from all sides, and salt if there's salt in the solution. And so this Brownian motion actually is heat. If you heat it up, then the motion will be larger. Heat on the microscopic scale is vibration on the macroscopic scale is what you feel as heat. This also can be radiation, for example, radiation, infrared radiation from a fire. You're sitting close to a fire, then you feel this heat. Last one is motion. Motion, wind energy or wind, the air element. The air element will correspond to kinetic energy. For example, if I take a potential energy, if I take here this scissor, then I move it away from gravity, then I pump in energy in it, then it has potential energy. If I then let it go, then the potential energy drags it down, and then it's converted to potential, to kinetic energy. This makes it moves. Then this energy is then, because of friction with the air, lost into the air. So it has fallen down. We can compute the content of energy in the scissor because of the distance from the Earth. And this energy difference has been lost to friction. But when it moves, it's kinetic energy. It's kinetic energy. That's the air element on the microscopic scale. On the macroscopic scale, it's something that is moving. Why can you not feel actually the fluid element? When you feel water in your hand, you can feel something. Yeah, you can feel it whether it's cut or whole, but that's hot or cold. That's not the water element itself. That's the heat element. Whether there is heat or not, cold is absence of heat element, or lower heat element that your 20 or 37 degrees body heat, or body temperature. Huh? So when you feel it's, whether you feel it's cold or hot, is has nothing to do with the water element itself. So therefore you cannot feel that. The second thing is that when you pour water, you'll feel some resistance, some weight of it. But this is actually not the water element itself. This is the solidity. In water there is, and this goes for all other physical things, there's a certain degree, for example also in this sitter, there's a certain degree of fluidity in this thing. There's a less than solidity at this temperature. If we take it up and it starts melting the plastic, then there will be then the fluidity element will be more obvious. Then it's also there's some heat element here, and it's there's also some potential energy lying in it. So there's also some element of motion in it. It can move. Huh? It's a, when it's up here, it has potential energy. Then it has the ability to move. If I don't keep it up, huh? So it has to, and this, so this means that this element is in there as a potential energy that can be converted at any point of time into kinetic energy, which is the element of movement. So basically, when you feel water, it is this, it is the extension that is the water is kind of like pushing little apart. This is the earth element, the solidity element. So when you feel water in your hand going, then it's kind of like pushing the hand, or you can kind of like feel it. Then it's, or if you take the hand through the water like that, you can feel that there's some resistance. Then what you feel there is the earth element, the solidity of it. Also, if you take air, actually, if you take a balloon or a plastic bottle or something and fill it completely with water, then you cannot compress it. It's uncompressible. Huh? The pressure just goes up. Or if you have a piston in a steel cylinder and you try to press down, you cannot press it down a millimeter. Huh? And that's because of the earth element that is present in this water. It keeps up. You cannot compress water at all. It's very, very little. Less than a per mil, less than a millionth. You can, because it just keep pushing away. So what you feel when you the two chances you have to feel water is, and you can also feel the of course regurgitate if water is flying through the air, there will be some element of motion also in it. But the water element, the fluid element, one cannot feel in itself. It's the three elements that one can regurgitate in any kind of fluid, but not the element of extension itself, because actually the neurons, you have to push the neurons, they have to be compressed for sending a nerve signals. If you're pulling it, doesn't really send any signal. Then there's three questions that are very good. In Buddhist country, there's three Pali sentences or kind of like texts that are repeated again and again and again. Iti piso bhagava arahan, start the first one. Bhagavata dhammo supatipanno bhagavato, and so on. I would like to say first off, just repeating the text. If you don't understand the text, then the words in themselves cannot confer any mental purity and have no effect. So therefore it's not a very good idea if you don't understand Pali, and nobody understands Pali completely. Nobody speaks it today and has not been spoken for 2,500 years. So it's better that you repeat it in your own language, which you understand well, or in English if you understand English well. In whatever language you understand the meaning of the language, then it has an effect on your mind, and on your then later on down the road on your behavior, and thereby for your future. But just repeating like a mantra doesn't have any effect. Doesn't have any effect. There are many here in Asia that believes that this has an effect. That sound in itself, the sound in itself has an effect. But that's, if you go into religion, comparable religion, that's actually a kind of animism. Just like the Indians, they run around a totem pole and worship the totem pole. that this should give them some good luck at the at when fighting and so on. But that's basically blind, completely blind superstition. And to repeat Pali text, for example, singing period protections and so on, and mantras and so on. This is also animism. This is also is making just making the words or the sound itself a totem. And this is this has nothing to do with what the Buddha said. He said you should tell the Dhamma in the language, in the local language that people understand. And this also goes when you should tell the Dhamma to yourself. Tell it in the any language, preferably your mother tongue, if it's translated to that mother tongue, or in any other language that you understand, but not in a language that you don't understand. It's kind of self-evident. But nevertheless, I just like to say that because it's often done repeatedly, blindly, repeating it as a parrot. The parrot doesn't understand what it says in many cases, but it can still say it. And this also goes for beings who are human beings who are repeating these texts can repeat them by heart, but don't understand what they mean. It's better to recite them without melody, in a loud, clear voice for yourself or inside your head, in the language that is your mother tongue. That's the ideal. It concerns the three jewels, Tirattana, the three jewels, the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha. The Buddha is the enlightened one, the perfectly self-enlightened one, the Sammasambuddhi, of which there is only one in our part of the universe, on planet Earth at a time. The Dhamma is a teaching, which is more like a natural law than a religious text or doctrine. And the Sangha is a community of the disciples, of the Buddhist disciples, that ascribes both as a living rule, as a discipline, and as a doctrine to the Dhamma. Itipi Soka said, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened is the Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior, totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be tamed, both teacher and guides, of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and enlightened is the Buddha. This was a text on the Buddha. The first jewel. The second jewel, the Dhamma, goes like this. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma. Visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, akaliko, inviting each and every one to come and see for themselves, inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and every one through progress towards perfection, directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. The third jewel, the Sangha. Perfectly training is this noble Sangha, Arya Sangha, community of the Buddha's disciple, training the right way, the true way, the good way, and the direct way. Therefore do these eight kind of individuals, the four noble pairs, deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation with joint palms. Since this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples is an unsurpassable and forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, and protect. With the last, the noble Sangha is a small subsection of the Sangha. It can be both lay people and ordained. It can be both male and female. They can be both human and non-human. they are at least 25% enlightened. Why are there 8 individuals? Because there's 2 parts of each step. Of there's 4 step, huh? There's a stream entrant, there's a once returner, there's a never returner, and there's the fully enlightened arahat. And on each step is a 2 state. The magga is the first moment you get, and then there's a phala, fruit, which is the joy you experience while being noble, repeatedly over, but not continuously, repeatedly over the state of being noble until reaching a higher state of being noble, until going 25% up again towards Nibbana. So there's 8. So this is a subset. Then there's a Samudhi Sangha. The conventional Sangha means all that are Buddhists that keep the 5 precepts and has taken these 3 jewels to them as a refuge, as a protection, as a shelter, as something that protects them. They have accepted that. They have accepted the Buddha as a teacher. They have accepted the Dhamma as a teaching and the doctrine that they follow forever hereafter. And they have accepted the Sangha, the community of the disciples, as their spiritual friends and teachers. Then they keep the 5 precepts also. This defines a Buddhist, that one has taken these 3 jewels, refuge in these 3 jewels, and one has accepted the 5 training rules, the 5 precepts. This defines a Buddhist. Having not done that, one cannot call oneself a Buddhist. One can take these 5 precepts at my website. That's the first, just say join the Noble Sangha, and then send an email to me, and 2,000 people have done so far from all over the world. And I'm very happy to know that 2,000 people have done it. These I know that they are Buddhist. All other people, I cannot say whether they're Buddhist or not, because they have not confirmed to me personally, directly, that they are Buddhist. They may be, they may not be. Even monks, they may be, they may not be. I don't know. As long as they have not confirmed to me that they have taken the 3 refuge and that they accept the 5 precepts, then I cannot know. But when they have done, I do know. This is usually something people do after, new Western Buddhists do after some years, after have considered it. And I'm happy when they do, after having considered it. Because it is not easy to keep the 5 precepts at all. It's not easy. So it's better coming close to it little by little and then think, now I'm ready. Now I'm ready to go open with it and to admit to myself and to others also openly, I'm a Buddhist. And I stand by it. And I stand by the 5 precepts. And then one can take the 5 precepts. And then, okay, now I'm a full-blooded Buddhist. And then I'll send out a confirmation to those who do it. So this is the meaning of this text. This is good to repeat this text for oneself. Why so? Because it increases faith, saddha, which then develops into confidence, which further develops into conviction over time. And this is what pushes beings along, because then they become, have given more devotion, bhakti in their heart. And then they make more effort. Then they become more aware. Then they become more concentrated. And then because of these developments of their mind, this purification of mind, which is gradual, then they gain more understanding. And that's a final end result. They get more understanding of what samsara is and how to get out of it, how to end suffering. They get understanding that is independent upon books and teachers and so on, because they have internalized it. They understand it themselves directly. Therefore, they can navigate better in the world. This was question 3, 4, and 5 regarding the 3 jewels, Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. Tisarana is to take refuge in these 3 jewels. Ti Ratana, the 3 jewels. How should one behave in order to be reborn in a higher than human world and still continue with Vipassana practice in these higher worlds or realms? We covered this a little bit before. I like to say that there's this 10 basis of meritorious actions, the Dasa Punya Kriya. This I will explain in detail then, but in kind of like an overview is keeping the five precepts all Buddhists have to do. Then is called Dana Sila Bhavana. Is Dana is generosity, giving to the poor and those who are worthy, and giving to those where you are happy to give. And ideally giving to a noble, if you can find one. And you are sure he's noble. Then this was the Dana part, the generosity part. Then there's the Sila part. This is the five precepts and the eight precepts at poor days, which is at every new moon, at every full moon. This is the Sila part. Then there's the Bhavana part. The Bhavana part has two components, meditation and study and reflection. Bhavana just means mental development. Let's say one only dana and sila. One is generous, and also one keeps the five precepts, and one study the Dharma text a little bit, and learns what is good and what is bad. But one doesn't do any meditation. One do reflection and study, and that's it. How far can one go? Then one can go up to level 11. We're now at level 5 of the 31 levels of existence. I place a link to the 31 levels of existence below, so one can read up upon the Buddhist cosmology about the devas, different kinds of devas. So here we are now, so you can go from 5 to 11 by that, but you cannot go to the Brahma level, the fine material level, because this will take meditation to one of the four Rupa jhanas. And to go even further than that, one has to go to do Arupa Jhana meditation, formless meditation, the formless absorptions, which is tricky. Even the first jhana of the Rupa Jhanas is tricky, but these are exceedingly tricky. There you get absorption, for example, into the thought of first that space is endless, the infinitude of space, the infinitude of consciousness, nothingness, and neither perception nor non-perception. These are the four Rupa Jhanas. These are tricky, just to gain Kasina meditation, absorption into blue color, for example, which is fairly easy. That is actually fairly difficult. To take, for example, consciousness Kasina, there you still have consciousness. It's not infinitude of consciousness, but consciousness itself. That is always also tricky, because it's not tangible. It's just something that is not visible. It's not sensible in the direct sense. So there you're trying to grasp something that is not graspable. And there the meditation object becomes tricky. It's much more easy to focus on the breath touching your nostrils, like in Anapanasati meditation, or on universal friendliness from you, beaming from your heart, like in metta meditation. Much more easy. This also, metta meditation can give access to the first jhana. Anapanasati meditation, breathing meditation, can give access to all four Rupa jhanas. So to answer the question, one just do these 10 meritorious actions, which I will explain in detail, and then keep the five precepts, and become generous. Ideally, so you have, at the moment of death, converted all your worthy, all your earthly earnings, all your bank accounts, and whatever value you have, this you have given away. So you have converted your bank account to your karmic account at the moment of death, fully. Then one will have a chance to go to a higher state. Then one wishes at the moment of death, may I practice Vipassana at that stage also. Wherever I arise, may I practice Vipassana at that stage for the merit I have done in this good, the good I have done in this life. This one remembers. But I'll just read up the text of the Buddha, what he said about these 10 meritorious actions and how to come, because there were some Brahmins, some Hindu priests that asked him about it. How do you come to the higher worlds? What do you do? And then the Buddha, he answered the following. These were householders. They were not monks. Householders. There are three kinds of bodily behavior in accordance with the Dhamma. That is righteous behavior. There are four kinds of verbal behavior in accordance with the Dhamma. Righteous behavior, verbal behavior. There are three kinds of mental behavior in accordance with the Dhamma. Righteous mental behavior. And how are these three kinds of bodily contents in accordance with the Dhamma? How are these three kinds of bodily behavior righteous? Here's someone. He stops killing living beings, becomes one who abstains from killing living beings. With rod and weapon laid aside, gently and kindly he abides compassionate towards all beings. Abandoning, stopping, what's taking what is not giving, stealing, he becomes one who abstains from taking what is not given. He doesn't steal. He does not take as a thief another's chattels or property in the village, nor in the forest. Abandoning wrong sexual behavior, one's sexual desires, he becomes one who abstains, stops any kind of wrong behavior in sexual desires. He does not have intercourse with such women who are protected by their mother, their father or mother, their brother, their sister, their relatives, or has as a husband, or one who is in a prison. And those who are betrothed or married or given away to others that are in love with others, these you also don't have sex with. This is the 10 wrong partners. Those who are protected by mother and father are, of course, children. So this means underage, pedophilia, he clearly explains here, is wrong sexual contract. That is how there's three kinds of bodily conduct in accordance with the Dhamma, which is righteous behavior in accordance with the Dhamma. That is not killing, not stealing, and no wrong sexual abuse. What are the four verbal behavior in accordance with the Dhamma? That is righteous behavior, righteous verbal behavior, righteous speech. Here's someone abandons false speech, becomes one who abstains, stops all false speech. When summoned to a court or to a meeting or to his relative's presence or to a guild of the royal family and questions as a witness, so good man, tell what you know. Not knowing, he says, I do not know. He does not not knowing, he says, I do not know. And knowing, he says, I know. Not seeing, he says, I do not see. I did not see it. And if he saw it, then he says, I saw it. He does not in full awareness speak falsehood for his own sins or for another's end or for some trifling worldly end. That is to say, he does not talk non-facts in order to protect himself or to protect another or for some trifling cause. He speaks the truth. Abandoning malicious speech, aggressive speech, he becomes one who abstains from malicious speech. One also divisive speech. He does not repeat elsewhere what is heard here for the purpose of causing division from these, nor repeat to what he has heard elsewhere, he repeats not here in order to cause division from those who are outside. He is one who is a reuniter of the divided, a promoter of friendships, enjoying concord, rejoicing in concord, delighting in friendship. He becomes a speaker of words that promotes concord. So this is divisive speech. That is a tricky one. Because if you tell a story about another that is a bad story, and you tell it to someone over there, then you cause a split between these two parties. Whatever kind of divisive speech. Don't do that. That's what the Buddha, he says here. Malicious speech, divisive speech. You say, you heard that this guy, he did this and that wrong. Or writing it down. And journalists do that all the time. ah, he killed somebody, blah 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 blah. So everybody was saying, ah, he's an asshole. He goes around and kills beings, or he stole this, or he told this or that lie. So what you have heard here, you don't tell there. What you have heard there, you don't tell there, because then you set a split in between these two parties. That's malicious speech, divisive speech. Don't do that. If you hear something here, that's private. You don't repeat somewhere else. You can repeat it in impersonal mode to someone here. So these beings over here, they cannot be identified. If there's something to learn from the story, you've heard some story here, they did this and that mistake, or blah, 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 and they did this and that, and there's something to be learned, then you can tell the story over here. If this person cannot be identified, then it's not divisive speech. But one cannot tell it as long as this person over here can be identified, because then it is divisive speech. Because these beings over here then will raise aversion towards you. So if they were friends before, they will be split. So what he says is that you want to reunite people who has been in some kind of conflict, and one should not in any way promote a splitting up of friendships. Abandoning harsh speech, aggressive speech, scolding. He becomes one who abstains from harsh speech. He becomes a speaker of such words that as are innocent, pleasing to the ear, and lovable, as go to the hearts, are civil, desired by many, and dear to many. Abandoning gossip, empty speech, blah, 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 blah. He becomes one who abstains from gossip, as one who tells what is seasonable, what is factual, what is advantageous, that which is Dhamma, that which is discipline. He speaks in time of what is worth recording, what is worth hearing, what is worth remembering, what is rational, what is definite, what is connected with good, what is advantageous. That is how there are these four kinds of verbal conduct in accordance with the Dhamma. Righteous speech in accordance with the Dhamma. So it is not lying, not, no false speech, no divisive speech, no aggressive speech, scolding, and no empty gossip. Blah blah blah. If she speaks about something, speaks about the Dhamma, speaks about something that is good, speaks about something that is rational, speaks of cause and effect, but just blah 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 blah. No. Silence is better then. How are there three kinds of mental contacts in accordance with the Dhamma? Righteous contacts. Here one is not covetous, he's not desire, he doesn't want something, somebody else. He's not a coveter of another's property, thus. Oh, what this is, if this, what another have, if it, this just was mine. He has no mind of ill will, with the intention of mind unaffected by hate, thus. May these beings be free from enmity. May they be free from affliction. May they be free from anxiety. May they live happily. So, first thing, he doesn't want other beings' things, other beings' money, other beings' lovers, other beings' houses, cars, position in society, whatever. He doesn't want. He has no desire to have somebody else's thing. The other one, he has no ill will towards. He wishes that may all beings be happy. May they be out without anxiety. He doesn't want something evil to happen to them. Or may they lose all their money. May they be divorced, or may they lose their social position, or may they lose their job at this or that company or at the university or whatever. He doesn't. He wishes them well. He has right view and undistorted vision such. There is what is given and what is offered and what is sacrificed. There's a fruit of ripening of good and bad karma. There's this world and there's the other world. And there's mother and father and spontaneously reborn beings. And good and virtuous monks and Brahmins that have by themselves realized by direct knowledge and experience this world and the other worlds as well. That is how there are three mental karmas in accordance mental actions, mental behaviors in accordance with the Dhamma. So there's three components here. He has no desire for other beings, that is one. Other beings' things, no greed for other beings' things or states or phenomena. He has no ill will towards other beings either. That's just second. No one. No, not even terrorists or killers or rapists or anyone else. He has great pity towards all these beings. Because why? Because he has this right view. Just go a little bit into detail with this right view, because this is a tricky one. That is what is given and what is offered and what is sacrificed. This is, if you give something, there will be a response back. It's good to give. If you don't give something, there will be nothing coming back to you. There's nothing on the other side of death. You'll be poor on the other side of death, in whatever state you arise. There's this world and the other world. There's many other worlds. There's this world, this is our world for we have together with the animals, and then there are 30 other worlds, or 29 other worlds. There are mother and father. You should take good care of your mother and father and respect them, because they have given you your entire life, and all the joy you experience in this life is directly caused by your mother and father. They're spontaneously born beings. This means to say that they are devas, they are, and also hell beings. They have no mother and father. They come, they are spontaneously reborn into that state. No mother or father, no egg, no nothing. They're good and virtuous monks and priests who have themselves, by themselves, realized by direct experience, they declare and explain this world and the next world, like I do right now to you. That is how there are three kinds of mental contacts. So holders, it is by reason of this behavior in accordance by the Dhamma that some beings here on the dissolution of the body after death reappear in a happy destination, even in a divine world. If a householder who observes conduct in accordance with the Dhamma, righteous conduct, should wish, all that on dissolution of the body after death might reappear in the company of warriors, of nobles of great property, it is possible that on the dissolution of the body, of the break of the body, after death, he may do so. Why is that so? Because he observed behavior that is in accordance with the Dhamma, righteous behavior. If householder who observes this conduct in accordance with the Dhamma, righteous conduct, should wish, oh, that on the break up of the body, after death, I might reappear in the company of the gods of the four great kings, it is possible that on the dissolution of the body after death he may do so. Why is that so? Because he observes the behavior in accordance with the Dhamma, righteous behavior. And so he explains that you can come in accordance, you can come in company with all the devas after having performed these 10 actions. That is, again, abstaining from killing, abstaining from sexual abuse, abstaining from stealing. That was just three connected with the body. And there's four connected with the mind, with the speech. Not lying, no divisive speech, no aggressive speech, no scolding, and no empty gossip. Now we have seven. Then there's three mental left. That is, no desire, no envious or jealous desire for other beings, things, and property. No ill will towards other beings. And thirdly, right view, that contains the karma, this world, other world, mother and father, spontaneously reborn beings, dana, the effect of giving, and thereby also the effect of non-giving. And as a last element, that there are priests and monks in this world who has by direct experience gained knowledge about this world and the other worlds and explained them to other beings. This is right view. Samaditti. This is the three verbal actions. So, for example, if one says three mental actions, say, there's no other world than the human world and the world we can see here. The world for us and the animals that are common. If there's no other words, then one is right view. Then you're down to nine. Then there's some divisive speech, are telling stories here about those people over there on the job, or blah, blah, blah. They did this and that wrong. And then you're down to 8. Huh? So it's cutting down. So these 10 causes of merit should be remembered. I think this covers this question. Then one, furthermore, then at the death moment and also before that, wishes. May I do vipassana, insight meditation or insight practice wherever I'm reborn, and this, then this will happen. As one is directing the good karma towards this goal, then this will happen. Did the Buddha ever speak about the wonder of life? No, he spoke about the wonder of consciousness and of the mind, that the mind was so quick that it could take any object up and leave any object just by quicker than you can snap your fingers. And so he spoke about the wonder of consciousness, of mind, but not of life. Please explain why a noble person does not feel any sorrow or sadness on account of all the beings suffering in samsara. There's two reasons. One is equanimity, upekkha, which is the last and the 10th perfection. It's not a cynicism, because you see what's going on. You also feel, because there's also karuna together, you feel the other beings suffering. But you also see that this suffering is self-inflicted, that they made it themselves. Their greed, their hate, and their ignorance of the Four Noble Truths made this suffering for them themselves. There's nobody else that has pushed this suffering onto them. They made it themselves. Why? Because they basically was ignorant and greedy and angry. And then they also got jealousy and envy and so on. So they start doing something and have done something for a long time that is now coming back as probability echoes that make them experience suffering. So it's seeing that race equanimity, that they didn't do it themselves. Nobody else did it for them. Their hate and their ignorance and their craving, their desire, lust, did it for them. But first of all, ignorance, deep down on the bottom, ignorance of the Four Noble Truths, did it for them. This state of not knowing the Four Noble Truths and not acting in accordance with the Four Noble Truths is what created the suffering for them. So one sees this, then it's just something that they have to go through. It's something that they have to dig through. Somebody will have a whole Himalaya mountain of pain they have to eat with a teaspoon. But you cannot go around and being sad about this all the time. Then you're suppressed, then you're crushed by this tragedy of samsara. So you have to just handle it in some way. But at first, I have to say, when I first saw it, really saw samsara and saw the other beings, how they are imprisoned in their own foolish ideas about what samsara is and not is, thereby completely unable to escape the suffering, then you're suppressed by it. Then you are sad. But by raising the equanimity, you become kind of like indifferent towards it. And then you can better handle it. Then there's another insight that comes a little later down the road. What makes beings actually enter the Noble Eightfold Path and take the Buddha as teacher and his monks as spiritual friends? It is the suffering. So suffering, as all coins, has two sides, and suffering also has two sides. There's the suffering side that is painful. It's painful mentally speaking, it's painful physically. Then there's the other side of this that is advantageous. That is what pushes beings towards Nibbana. Because if they were satisfied with the situation as it were, as samsara were, even though they were dying and so on, becoming old and dying, then they would not do something else. And that's a deva situation, actually. They have no motivation, because they suffer so little, they are so in so luxurious, they are kind of like anesthetized by luxury. So they don't feel any acute need for doing anything to make their life change. This is more acute for human beings and even more acute for animals, but animals have a lot lower ability to do it. Human beings has this right balance between neutral feeling, painful feeling, and happy feeling. We have all three. Then also mental abilities that can understand the vulnerable truth, and that's why we should do it. So suffering has these two sides, and this is seeing and knowing that, that's understanding, that's panya. That is the suffering that gives people faith, that make them seek the Buddha, make them seek the Dhamma, make them seek the Sangha, to get some protection, to get some meaning into their life, and to see that there is something else, that you can go to a place where there is no pain, that doesn't contain pain, and that is the highest bliss there is in the world. Nibbana, Paranam Sukham. Nibbana is the highest bliss. It's also an absolute freedom from all suffering, first of all. And it's deathless, it's deathlessness. And this element, Nibbana Dhatu, is existent, is the solution to the problem of suffering. But this faith, where does it come from? It comes from dukkha, it comes from suffering. It is born out of suffering, otherwise it doesn't arise. So this is why the noble doesn't feel sad about it, because everybody has to learn it, has to learn the Four Noble Truths. Otherwise, they cannot go out of samsara. They cannot end suffering. It's impossible to end suffering without knowing the Four Noble Truths, and it's impossible to approach enlightenment without knowing the Four Noble Truths. The fourth truth is the Noble Eightfold Way. So that is the only way out. So of course you have to know the Four Noble Truths. So what make you approach this is the suffering. So this is the good side, you can say, of suffering. It is that it pushes the beings towards progress. And seeing this, first of all, suffering is inevitable. Suffering is created by the individuals themselves. That makes a difference. You cannot do something about it. You can tell them how to do it, but they have to do it themselves. They have to improve themselves. I cannot purify you. You cannot purify me. Nobody can purify another. It's impossible. We can tell how to do it, but they have to do it themselves. So one is not involved in that in any way. If one doesn't harm other beings, if they suffer, that's their business, basically. One can try to help them in any possible way. But if it's karmically related, we then often see if you give them money, then they throw them away or spoil them on something. Or if you give them food, then they also spoil it. If you give them whatever, they cannot gain it if there's not the karmic probability to get it. Then they will get suffer. Same also with the disease. If the disease is karmically related or caused karmically related, then no medicine works. No surgery works. They will get work for a short time, then they get the disease, same disease back again. This is because this karma is probability that says that this has to be so. Who planted this probability? A combination of their greed, hate, and ignorance planted this further down the road in the past. And that's why they are discovering now. If one can explain that to them and they can understand, then they will be curing. But in most cases, you cannot explain it. They will say, that's bullshit. Because this, what I did in the past has nothing to do with my disease now. And they say, okay, back out. You cannot do anything. If you cannot do anything, there's no need to feel sorrow. There's no need to be glad either. It's just as it is, just seeing it as it is. These beings has to learn it the hard way. We have the saying in Danish, if you cannot hear, then you have to feel. Feel what? Feel suffering, feel pain, feel frustration. If people give you advice and you spit them in the face by saying, what you say is bullshit, then they will have to feel the pain. They have to learn it the hard way. Well, so be it. So be it. That's the equanimity that sets in. Right there, the equanimity sees that there's no way you can help this being. Then it backs out. This is not sad, it's not glad, It's neutral feeling. It's just accepting it as it is. It's in a form of acceptance on a very deep level, because it has been practiced before. You have seen this before, that beings cannot be helped. Some few beings, when I measure it, approximately 3.6%, that is one out of two school classes, can be helped. The rest cannot be helped. And it's finding these 3.6%, four people out of 100, finding these four people out of 100, that's the trick. That's the art of the game that I try to practice and that you should practice also. Because you are seeing this, have seen this Dhamma speech to the end, there's a very high probability that you actually are one of these four out of 100. I congratulate you with that. Keep on tracking. That's all for today. Remember to click subscribe there, and have a nice day. 1 hour and 58 seconds. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened is the Blessed Buddha. Remember to send in new questions you have, any doubts that you cannot resolve yourself by conferring to the text, to me, Bhante, Bhante, Samahita, Samahita, @gmail.com. Thank you for your attention. May many beings be happy by this information.